8 o'clock. How long do I think this is going to take? Where did I put my keys? Why am I thinking about that? We're going to end about 8:40 tonight. Want people to get a chance for prayer. Want to make sure I cover everything. So if you're new and you have to use the bathroom, here's what I usually do. I usually open up with a prayer, and then I spend about 5 to 10 minutes wasting your life in a story. That's a great time to go pee. Don't wait to the end. That's where I finally get anointed, okay? All right? So that should give you a perspective about what the night will look like. And we'll do the good Southern Baptist thing. Amanda will come out and play the organ, and I'll get all dramatic. But either way, listen with your heart, all right? So make sure I didn't miss anything. All right. Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for everything that you're doing. Thank you that you are the author of humor. You created us to laugh. And in your presence, there's freedom to do that. And with that freedom, we can laugh at just life. We can laugh at things that are funny. And like was said earlier by Allison, we can laugh at adversity. We can laugh at some things that, you know, we can say, you know what, you're not going to win. You're not going to win. And God, we just lift you up right now. We take our own crowns of knowledge and our own symbols of our status and reputation, and we just lay them down at your feet and say, Father, speak to us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said? Amen. You guys ever hear of the good, there's a guy in our country, his name's Arnold Schwarzenegger. I think we've heard of him. You know, the Terminator, you're right. He came over from like Europe and just totally dominated the powerlifting scene. And then he goes in, we see him in a movie. I believe his first movie was like Conan the Barbarian, which was amazing, which was a childhood like favorite of mine. I loved it. He was absolutely awesome. That would later go on to become the governor of the state of California. But what people don't know, little things they don't know about Arnold Schwarzenegger, is he was actually really wealthy before he ever got picked up by Conan the Barbarian, by the movie. He was actually really wealthy. He was a self-made entrepreneur that he actually ran his own like concrete home remodeling design company. Is one of the things he did because he always believed that hard work and ethic always paid off. And he was always plotting in his head. He'd tell you that in his book, he writes about it. He's always going through his head. So he's like, when I'm going to make my bicep big, I don't make my bicep big. I make my chest big and my legs big. And then when he would go into competitions, if he didn't, you know, want somebody, if you saw his competitor, if like Jason and I are obviously competitors in a bodybuilding competition, you want to give him a flex down, you know, like, he would go up to Jason and be like, oh, you're looking good for the competition. Did you hurt your leg? They're looking small. And then he would walk away knowing Jason would just be working his legs for the rest of the week to exhaustion to get himself tired before the competition. And he'd walk up to other people and be like, oh, are you okay? You are looking sickly. No, I hope you get better. You will. And the person would be like, oh my gosh. And he would mess with their minds. And I'm like reading this thinking, Schwarzenegger, you crafty dog, you. But nothing beats what he would do in his first business, in his concrete business. He would go to people like if Sean Diaz, recently married, come on. All right, recently married. If he needed concrete work at his house, and he called up Schwarzenegger's company, and Schwarzenegger had another Austrian friend, I believe it was Austrian friend, that would come with him. Now, keep in mind, he's also powerlifting. Keep in mind, he's also a world-renowned powerlifter still. So the guy is ginormous, all right? And he'd walk up, and he would know that in the economy of the 70s that he might not get the price bid that he wanted. So he would go, and he'd be talking to me and say, hey, well, tell me everything that you want. And he'd walk through it, and he'd be like, okay. And then they'd be like, well, how much are you looking to spend on that? And they'd be like, well, about $1,500. And he goes, okay, well, let me go talk to my partner and see what we can do, because this all sounds doable. Like, we can do this. So Sean would be like, okay, great. Then he'd walk over to his partner, who's also Austrian, and be like, start talking to him. And they would literally get in each other's faces like pro wrestlers and start yelling at each other. But he said they would yell stuff like, are you coming over for dinner tonight? Yes, me and Sally might come over for dinner tonight. What do you want to eat? Pork chops sounds good. But to the person who didn't speak their language, it looked like they were fighting really bad. Then he would walk back over to the guy, knowing they could totally do the $1,500 job for $1,000, and say, my friend is not happy, but we can do it for $2,200. For you, because we like you. And the guy would go, okay. And boom, he would make tons of money that way. It's like, what? Are you serious, Schwarzenegger? That's how you did it? And it's like, but we all like have that in our lives, right? We all have those areas in our lives. And I don't care if you're loud and you're boisterous like Arnold, or if you're a church mouse and you're quiet. There's areas where you know that you can finagle and tweak. And there's techniques that you know that you can do to get what you want. You know, with your parents, there's stuff you can say that might shift their attitude. Topics you can bring up. You're able to manipulate a bit and get in there a bit and work the system till you can actually get what you want, all right? How many of you guys say amen to that? You know that's true. All right, every woman in the house better say amen. I don't care, throw your shoes at me. But you do, you know. You're like, okay, I'll just stop talking to him. I ain't going to talk till he cracks. And sure enough, the guy's going to be like, what's wrong? Are you okay? And then he starts thinking about everything he said in the last 20 minutes. What did I say? Was it the perfume thing? Is it the song? You know, like, what is it? Like, you know there's stuff that you can do that can change the direction of where and what things are going and how you get stuff and how you affect people. And it really comes down to this. It really comes down to this, is in getting what we want. Is how do we get what we want? How do we get what we want here in this world? And if you ask some Christians, you say, well, if you want something, then just pray about it and God will give it to you. And I have to say yes to that, because that's like the thing I have to say yes to, because it's so vague. I can't say no to it. But it's really stupid advice, because how do you do that? Like, so I'm going to like focus in a little bit more on how we actually do that. And the real enemy of that, the real enemy of the, okay, pray and believe God for it, because I believe and I know and I've seen over the years that this manipulation, this twisting, this deceit, this even, it might not be bad. You might not be bold out lying. What Arnold did was not like, oh my gosh, Arnold, that was so horrible. We smile a little bit, that crooked little evil smile, because like, that's funny. That's shady. I don't know if I can do it as a Christ-loving believer, but that's funny. But I don't know if I want that to be my reputation. So how do we do this? How do we do life? And the problem is, the biggest thing, the thing that gets in our face the most, that will draw us into this area of plotting out to do something that we know we might not want to do, or we can't tell our mama about it, we can't tell the 6 o'clock news about it, and you can't tell your preacher about it, all right? Or you have to do this before you say it. You're usually about to tell a racist joke, but one thing will consistently draw you into that area, and that's temptation. That's whatever your, honestly, whatever your idol calls you to, the temptation. So how do we fight temptation here? What are we tempted by, and what's a good godly thing? How do we know the difference? Because sometimes it can be so blurred. Like, you could say, I want to preach the gospel. And another person says, I want to preach the gospel. But one of them wants to see thousands of people saved. The other person wants to be seen by thousands of people. So how do you know? How do I know? How do I know when my heart has not gone wrong? When I need to say, wait a second, I'm falling into the spider web of temptation, and I need to know that this is not the right road for me, and I need to back up, and I need to get away from it. And this, there's areas we really get tempted in three majorly big areas our whole life, and they transform the way they look. But it is so true that they are on us, and they challenge us, and we have to make sure and be realizing and open to that none of us are impervious to temptation. So if you have your Bibles here, if you'll open them to Matthew 4, we're going to take a look at a portion of Scripture. We're going to jump into this for a while. And if you want to save time later, I'll be going to Psalm 132 at the end. So really, Matthew 4 and Psalm 132. Get your pens ready, get your highlighters ready, get your apps ready to highlight some stuff and to write some stuff, because God's going to do some surgery. It's almost like when it came to dealing with the devil, dealing with the Schwarzenegger, dealing with people, and it's almost like what would happen if someone called his bluff, right? And they're standing there yelling at each other in Austrian about pot pies and what they're going to have for dessert, and someone said, I call your bluff. No, you can do it for cheaper than $2,200. You'd be like, what? What do we do then? Well, I've always wondered that. What would we do? What would he do if someone called his bluff? If he goes, hi, Kyle, your legs are looking scrawny, you know? And Kyle goes, no, actually, my legs are perfectly fine. I can't wait to crush you this weekend in a competition. What happens if you called Arnold's bluff? Guess what? Nothing. Nothing. He could do nothing else to that person besides maybe eat you because he's a human monster, you know? Matthew 4, now that you've turned there, try to get you a little time so you don't feel like that church preacher pressure, like you got to flip through really fast. You rip the whole book of James out of your Bible. Like, he's not important anyways. But I'm just kidding. It's a great book. It is a great book. We're doing a message series on it. I'm sorry. Matthew 4, verse 1, that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. What was that? Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Some of us have an ideology here that once we get saved, that God will put his hands around us and we'll never experience a bad moment again in our life. That is absolutely absurd, and that is not what the Bible says. That where God is calling you, there will be temptation around you. And make sure you know crystal clear when you leave these walls, you are not walking into Kumbaya Central, but this is the wilderness that we live in. And we need to be prepared, because guess what? I see too many Christians walking around like they're in Santa's North Pole rather than they're in a war zone where there's a real enemy trying to eat their lunch and hurt their family. What's the real is that the Spirit led Jesus there, because the Spirit knows how fully powerful you are being partnered with him. So he's not afraid of the accuser. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. Notice that. Now, he was led to temptation before he started fasting. The fasting process happened during this struggle. We have to be ready in season and out of season for this temptation to pop up. None of us, I don't care, you can think right now the most holiest person in the room, only half of you are thinking me, and you guys are wrong, but whatever, doesn't face temptation. Everybody faces temptation. It just looks differently. The tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. He hasn't eaten in 40 days. All right? You think P90X will make you lose some weight? Homeboy's probably dropped some pounds. And here's the devil dropping Panera down in front of him, saying, tell these stones to become bread so you can eat. I don't know about you, but when I get hungry, I change. I become a different person. I don't even like me when I'm hungry. When I come home, Nancy has a plate sometimes, not because I'm some like 1950s husband. It's because she's an amazing wife, and she loves the man she fell in love with, not the O.J. Simpson that comes through the door when he hasn't eaten. Too soon? Let go of it, people. He was innocent, all right? Like, I'm joking about that, by the way. I don't know what he was, and it's not my job to say the verdict from 25 years ago. Because that messes with me. in the flesh, in your flesh, your hunger drives you, man. It eats you up. You're like, man, he's saying, look, you can what? You can use what your father has given you to get rid of what's hurting you. You can use that voice and how you sing to go to every bar from Monday night to Tuesday night to Wednesday night through the whole week and sing and get guys' attentions and girls' attention, and you can be the man or you can be the woman. You can use the gift God has given you to end the pain that's in you right now. All you gotta do is what I say. Turn these rocks into stone. Some of us are using our gifts for the wrong kingdom. You know, it's like this. Many of us think that there's the kingdom of heaven, there's the kingdom of hell, and then there's the kingdom we build here. The truth is this. There's the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of hell, and you're working for one of them. Know what you're using your gift for. Jesus is like, I'm not doing it. Yeah, I'm hungry, but I'm hungry. And I get that. I'm hungry, and I've been through it. And if my father brought me through 40 days of the wilderness of being hungry, he'll bring me through 41 days. I'm not listening to you. And some of us have to realize that if he's brought us through 18 years, 20 years, 26 years, 30 years on this earth, and he hasn't let us die yet, he's going to bring us through 30, 60, 20 more. That we don't have to bow a knee. And Jesus answers. I love this. It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. He says, what I need to live here comes from my Father, not from this place and not from you, devil. I love that. I love that, because the areas where we really get pushed in this, where we really have to assess what we believe and what we do. Well, one is sex. One is sex, because that's a hunger inside our flesh that is like, do I really need to like give an analogy now? I think we all can just say amen and move forward. There's a hunger there, all right? That gets our attention, that drives us, that controls us. Listen, guys, let's be real, all right? You've gone to aisles in Walmart that you have no reason being on because there's a pretty girl there. All right? You're over there looking at toasters. Your mom has 4 toasters in the house where you live. Target, too. That's upscale. That's upscale. That's that soccer mom place. Stay out of there, Hector. We're praying later. Got you. Get the prayer counselors up. We got to do this now. It is. It's true. You'll go out of your way. You know, if there's a pretty girl in one of your classes, man, first thing you're doing the next day is looking for a new cologne, hoping that the seat's open next to her, hoping that she walks slow for somehow you can find a reason to go talk to her if you have courage. All right? That's a whole nother sermon. It drives us. Same with girls. All right? I don't need to go into a whole list with the girls. I'll just say one word, 2 words. The Bachelor. All right? Y'all are all up in that show. Like, you're going to marry this dude, all right? And, like, it's your sisters and friends on it. And I'm not looking at anybody in particular, but everybody in particular, all right? Because why? You got that drive in you for a husband or a man or whatever. And you know what? I ain't even going to hate. Me and you might be gay, and you still know what that feeling is, all right? You know what that feeling is. We're not hating on nobody here right now. That drive is in us. And if you allow it to stay in you without addressing it, you're allowing it to control you. I don't want to walk around Walmart or Target or any store for no reason. Now, you might think, well, how do you know it's not my future wife? Okay, well, let's not talk about you for a second. Let's talk about me, my favorite subject. All right. I'm married. I got no reason to be on the toaster aisle of Target, all right? I need to go home to my baby, to my sweet oven, to my other appliance. I don't need to be shopping on the appliance aisle there. Smallville might get a little rough tonight. But how do I not do that as a married man? I'm just going to preach to you guys. All right? Just going to preach to you guys. How do I not do that as a married man? I don't do it as a single man. I don't slither around the stores and the beach and the other place. I don't cut through Cocoa Village or drive down the A1A areas where the girls are walking around doing their thing. I don't do that as a single man. I didn't do that as a single man. Why? Because I don't want to do it as a married man. I want to be able to say, no, I want to go home to my wife. I want my mind focused on kingdom things. I want my wife to know that my heart is hers, that she never has any doubt if I'm home late or if something goes down, that she's never like having to worry like, oh my gosh. You know, so you got to look at what you're doing now. This just doesn't, you don't flip this switch on once you're married. It doesn't work like that. And same with young ladies, man, same with young ladies. Don't allow yourself to talk about a man, as fine as he may be, as if you are an unsaved man. As if you're a construction worker out on some job site and some girl walks by. And I do that. I'll hear some young ladies sometimes, Christ-loving, spirit-filled believers will be like, oh, that guy, he is just, I'm like, we're called to be fruitful and multiply, you know? Get your love on, you know? But at the end of the day, you're a lady and you have value. And you say, you know what, man, he is handsome, and he is attractive, but I'm not going to allow a place in my heart where I become something that's less than what Christ paid for. All right, if you're new here, maybe you live with your girlfriend or boyfriend. I don't cast stones. I ain't telling you to break up. I ain't telling you to move out. I ain't telling you to do any of that stuff. But sex is amazing. All right, and it is amazing on the level of you need it for your marriage to keep you guys closely bonded together. It can really get you through some amazing stuff, some hard stuff, some tough times. It keeps you guys centralized. Sex is so important. It is so important in marriage. Married couples, man, do your best to have sex as often as possible. That's why we don't give it away to people that don't deserve it. All right? Because it's your way of saying that this is what we do and no one else does this with us but us. And your sex, I'm not going to try to get weird. Once again, I'm not going to look at anybody. I'm just going to look right up there at the clock. Your sex will be customized to the two of you, and it'll be a beautiful thing and a passionate thing. So if you're a virgin and you're worried that you need to read the Karma Sutra and learn new spin moves and this and that, you don't need to do that. You don't need spin moves, all right? God has built you. Nobody post any of this portion on Facebook. Please, dear God. God has what? God has everything you need for that appetite that's in your body. Everything you need for the appetite that's in your body. You don't need to turn that stone into bread. You don't need pornography. You don't need to be getting the attention of all these women or all these men. You need to be preparing your heart for the one who's going to come, who you're going to spend forever with. Don't turn the stones to bread. I tell you what, this is something you'll never see before, a hot sex scene in any movie, but I'm just going to drop the lovemaking tips out on you right now. I don't know why. I didn't have an energy drink or nothing. And this is going to be weird. You won't see it in any sitcom either where you think that that's how stuff really goes down. If the couple prays together, it's good. I'll just leave it like that. Pray before you make love. We have a lot of married couples here, engaged couples, all that jazz. And believe it or not, it's cool. So that's as awkward as I want to make this moment. And I'm just going to move forward with the rest, all right? Next craving that comes up in our body, that temptation that draws us out, is drugs and alcohol. I hate to say drugs, I feel like I'm a sixth grade, like, don't do drugs, kids, it's bad. Like, do drugs if you want to, it's your life, you know. Drink if you want to, it's your life. Just don't bite into the lie that you need that to relax, that you need that to have a good time. You need that to take the edge off. You need that to what? To be able to hang out. It's your pick-me-up. It's how you get the weekend started. It's how you blow off some steam. Lie, 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 lie. God says that I have a peace for you that surpasses all understanding. He says, you can go and rest in me, and I will blow your mind like no drug could ever touch. I can give you inspirations for songs to write, paintings to paint, you know, man, sermons to preach. I can give you inspiration on what you need to help the people around you, problems that you, God's just eager to solve them with you, but you're soaking your brain and getting it far away from him. Matter of fact, most successful people, I read this book, it was a collective of successful people, actually titans of our generation, and they all say the same thing, that they never allow alcohol too much into their mind, because the lie is that more alcohol makes you more creative. It actually makes you more useless the more you put it in you. You don't need it to write. You don't need it to dance. I mean, just look at Allison and Nikki. Have they needed any alcohol? Have you seen them as all this stuff? We needed alcohol afterwards, but no, I'm just joking. You don't need alcohol to have fun. That's the heartbeat of the mezzanine here. You don't have to do that. You know, if you're struggling with it, man, come here. You don't have to. We don't bite in it. And if you do, we're not hating on you. All right? Because guess what? I'm not here to put a law on you. I'm not here to tell you. What I'll tell you is this. Put it on the altar before God in your prayer life. Say, God, is this what's good for me anymore? Or maybe you're asking me to lay this down. But you need to pray. And you say, okay, God, where you're leading me, is this coming with me? Is this coming with me? The next one is really just food. That sounds crazy, but it's true. Is that we live in a culture where food could be a comfort to us, and we just eat and eat and eat. And then we hear all this self-help stuff that's like, you're perfectly fine the way you are. And I want to say, yes, you are perfectly fine and beautiful the way you are and the way God created you. I'm not trying to get fanatic with this. But if you have a problem medically in your body, and you know you cope with it by eating, get help. Like, don't be embarrassed. Same if someone had a drinking problem. Get help. Or if you're addicted to a substance or a pill, get help. Or if you're not eating because you have an image, you know, something going on with the way you see yourself, get help. Don't be embarrassed. You know, man, this self-punishing cycle that beautiful people go through because of what and how they operate with food, because of their image, it can be swept under the rug in the church sometimes, because we don't want anybody to feel like anything's wrong, all right? And I'm not saying if you're just, you got a little bit of mayonnaise, you know, because you went back to school and you had a couple kids. I'm not talking about anybody in the room. I'm talking about the people who are like, you know what? You know who you are. And I'm not looking at anybody. I'm just saying is get help. Talk to somebody. Say, look, I think it's gone far enough, and I want to do something about it. We got to be proactive. There's this temptation out there that will draw us out. If it's not food, then it's sex that will draw us out to want to go do something. If it's not sex, then it's that something that will give us enjoyment, that will take the stress off, that will try and give a false peace to us. And we've got to be careful. We've got to know that God says, look, I have given you every gift that you need to have in this world, and you have it upon your salvation. Many of us, plausibly before our salvation, he even gave us some of the gifts that we don't need to bow to the temptations that are in our life. But the conversation between the accuser and Jesus did not stop there. As many of you know, that they would go on to have a further discussion, the devil then chiming in and saying and responding with, the devil took him to the holy city, which is Jerusalem, and had him stand on the highest point of the temple and said, if you are the Son of God, wait a second, if you are the Son of God, I think we've seen this from the devil before. He's trying to slip doubt in to Jesus by asking a question, the same as he did with Adam and Eve. Did God say not to eat that fruit? If you're the Son of God, when that starts coming up, am I saved? Is God mad at me? Am I able to, you know, can I still, you know, am I still being blessed even though I've made this mistake, that I've gone through something? You need to respond back with the word and say that I am his son, that I am his daughter, of whom he is well pleased. We cannot walk around doubting, allowing him to ask that simple, stupid question to us. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written. What? The dynamic of this fight just shifted. Jesus said, it is written. Now what's the devil answering back with? Oh, you want to use the word? I'll use the word too. It is written. And okay, okay. It is written, he will command his angels concerning you that they will lift up their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. He's quoting Psalms 91, I believe 11 right here, when he's saying this to Jesus, saying the very Bible, scripture says that you cannot even stub your toe. You cannot even stub your toe, Messiah. Then jump off this. Jump off the highest point of the biggest building in the holiest city, which is almost a smack in Jesus' face, because that city and that building is meant to give his God, his Father, praise and honor. And the devil wants to use it to make him have a giant fall. The devil tries to do that. He tries to get you into church so he can point out people so you can take a great fall. See what she's wearing? She's such a hoochie. Oh, see him over there? See how he does that? He just thinks he's so full of him. He thinks he's the man. He ain't nothing. He walks around like he's got lats and he weighs 95 pounds. And what's happening? You're getting bitterness inside. You're the one struggling with stuff. They're having a great time at Mezzanine. You're over there in the corner all mad. Don't be in the presence of God taking a fall because what you've allowed into your heart. Jesus answered him. I love how Jesus' answers are so short, all right? You don't need to have long-winded conversations with liars. Just respond with the truth. It is also written, counterpunch, pah. Do not put the Lord your God to the test. You see? See what Jesus is doing here? Jesus has Schwarzenegger there talking in Austrian, and Jesus is saying, you're bluffing. You're bluffing. Nope, I'm calling you out. Devil, oh, I'm going to starve. You're bluffing. What's next? Am I going to die? Oh, I'm still alive. Yeah, look at this. I'm ripped now. Brings him to the temple. Oh, yeah. Okay, so if I don't do this, somehow you put doubt in me that God's not there for me, that God's not going to protect me, God's not going to provide for me. You know, that's what he wants to do. He wants you to start thinking, you know what? What about my future? How am I going to pay for my bills? How am I going to pay for a wedding? I haven't seen my parents in years. How am I going to pay for my car? I'm drowning in debt. How am I going to get out of the student loans? How am I going to make rent? How am I going to do all this stuff? And it's going through your head. And he wants to say, did God say he would exceedingly and abundantly supply your needs? Did he say, but what does that really mean? Maybe that just means you'll go to heaven, right? Because that's, after all, that's what we just be focused on. It's just going to heaven. And that's not what Jesus is saying here. That's not what's going on here. You know what he wants Jesus to do? He wants Jesus to doubt and to test that God will provide and protect him. He wants you to doubt that God will show up and provide for you in areas of lack and protect you in areas where you're vulnerable. He wants that. And it's scary because you know what? What does that mean? We have to go into areas where we do not allow our heart to budge. We do not. I just watched this amazing movie called Hacksaw Ridge. Anybody see that? Where that guy would not care. We need to have a men's night and watch that. And like, oh my goodness, this guy would not carry a weapon into World War II. And I won't ruin the movie for you, but please, I don't endorse a lot of movies. Go see that movie. It was absolutely amazing. And we need to have a resilience that says, you know what, devil? No matter what, even if my bill doesn't get paid, I'm not doing what that temptation is drawing me to do. Even if I do get hurt, how many of y'all know the missions field can be dangerous? Amen? The missions field can have problems in it. That stepping out into even our own community saying the name of Jesus puts a spotlight on you that can bring some trouble to your forehead. But guess what? We can't let that stop us. We have to call the enemy's bluff. We have to call the bluff and say, my God will provide for me. My God will keep me safe. You know what? Lots of times too, I just think about it. I think about it because it's like when it goes through, when he's saying this, I can just hear Jesus now saying, did he just say, if I am the Son of God? You know how like when someone says something to you, you get hung up on that sentence and you can't go any further? It's like, did he just say that? They just say that? It's like, did he just say? I wondered if Jesus even heard the rest of what the devil had to say. Did he just say, that? I'm about to lose my mind on this kid again, all right? Like, I can't believe that. I bet he was like, you know what I am? I am the Son of God. I am the Son of God. Guess what? I am his masterpiece. I am his work. That I am not here. That, you know what? Out of all of this that he sent me from heaven to earth to do, that it is not my place to test my Father. It's my place to obey him. It's my place to love him. It's my place to be blessed by him, to praise him, to trust him. But I have never once been called to test him. And I won't do it. I won't do it. I don't live a life where I'm testing God. Some of you guys now are thinking of the scripture in Malachi where it talks about test me with the finances. Okay, he put that out there because those people were in lack and in unbelief. I don't want God to have to challenge me to be obedient to what should already be in front of me. Jesus would even say himself, look at the birds of the air. Do they not sow or reap or store away in barns? And yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you much more valuable than them? When you start worrying about your safety and your finances and your provision, you don't have the image of the value that you have in God's heart. If my daughter came to me and said, Daddy, will you make sure that I have food for the rest of the week? I would be like, did you just ask me that, baby? Do me a favor. Don't ever ask me that again, because I never want you worrying about that again. If my son ever came to me and said, Dad, will you make sure that I'm taken care of, that there's a roof over my head and there's clothes on my back? I'd be like, listen, my little Ewok son. Chewbacca has you covered. This tree is plentiful. I guess he lives in trees. I don't know. Think about what you're asking God. You think he's not bigger than that student loan? You think your God ain't bigger than that credit card? But you understand, I spent it all on strippers and bar tabs. You think he's not bigger than it? You think he's not abundantly crazy that you've repented and turned from it? You think he's like sitting up there saying, well, you did it, now you're going to walk in it. No, he's saying, you did it, but I paid for it. Let's clean it up. Let's clean it. Let's get you back in the right direction. Let's get that broken thinking out of here. Because that's exactly what your Father's looking to do. That's exactly one of the reasons of many why Jesus went to the cross. These birds don't even, the birds don't tithe. The birds aren't my family. You're my family, is what he's saying. How much more I care about you. The conversation does not end there. Conversation does not end there with the devil. Boy, I love it. Once again, he's like, oh, yeah, you think that I'm going to starve to death? You think that I need to turn my back on God and trust and get in a relationship with you, devil? You're bluffing. You're powerless. Oh, you think I need to worry about my provision and my protection? You're bluffing. You're powerless. Then he says this. And again, the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their splendor. And all this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Finally, he got hot under the collar. Finally, he popped and said exactly what he wanted. Because in those first two situations, it's like that drug dealer deal where he's like, yeah, you can get the first one for free. No, it's on me, buddy. Don't worry about it. Yeah, we're cool. And you do some cool handshake thing that I'm not cool enough to do. But he has a full intention to what? Have you inevitably paying the highest price to bow at his feet. And that's exactly what the devil was doing. But Jesus said, you're bluffing. Next card. If we're playing poker, flip the next card. Oh, yeah, you're still bluffing. And then finally he comes out and he says, you know what? Fine. He goes, I'm all in. I will give you everything in this world. I will give you everything in this world if you bow at my feet. That's what he says to him. And Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. He said, you fool. This world doesn't mean anything when you've been in the presence of the one who is everything. And I will spend eternity with him. You cannot tempt me what happens here for what I know I'm going to receive and from there. We have to look at this life through a kingdom point of view. If you have not, it's because you ask not. And some of us ask amiss. This is James. Shouldn't have thrown his book out. Which just means you're asking kind of out there. You're asking differently than what you should be asking. What he's saying is just get back to focusing in the will of God. Jesus is saying, I'm not going to bow down to you. You're bluffing. You can't give me everything, and you can't really fulfill the hunger that is inside of me. Why? But notice something else that he goes, turn these stones into bread. Come on. You can do it. I'm going to get you on the ground level. I'm a big leadership like fanatic. I love John Maxwell. I love to read General Patton's writings. I love leadership stuff. That's why I said, I alluded to earlier, I have a big giant book of all of the greatest titans of industry, saved and unsaved. And I love to just sit and listen to and read about their thoughts. And watch this principle for all of you who want to be world changers, all of you that want to make a dynamic difference while you're here on earth. The devil goes, I can help you here. I got something here. Here's stones. Turn to bread. Oh, no, not that. Then he goes, what I'll do? I'll bring you up a little bit higher. Okay, cool. Still no deal? Okay, cool. Now I'm going to take you to the highest point in the mountain and on the mountain. Let me tell you this. Some of us, you need to realize that the devil is looking to elevate you quickly. You need to make sure that your rise is from the hand of God and not because you are bowing down to the wrong person. Okay? Because the race that we have been called to is one of endurance. It's one of persistence. It's one of faith. It's one of saying that I will not give in. I did not give in yesterday, and I will not give in today, nor will I give in tomorrow. I might be beaten down. I might be bruised. I might be persecuted, but I am not giving up, and I will not stop this race that I am running. Whether my promotion comes tomorrow or the next day, it doesn't matter because I know the one who promotes and I know why I'm running this race. Too quickly, we're like, oh, I can get everything. And what happens on top of the mountain? On top of the mountain, he tries to sell you, look, all you would do is bow to me, then everybody would answer to you. And some of us would have the mindset of, okay, yes, you know how much good I could do if I was the boss of the shift, if I was the shift supervisor. You know how amazing that would be? The shift supervisor now, he's a jerk anyways. He's a scumbag. So what if I did just keep emailing his boss all the stuff that he's doing behind his back? What if I did do some shady stuff like that? Then I could lead so many people to Jesus once I become the leader. What? Are you serious? Oh, man. Yeah, if I could be up there preaching, oh, yeah, I know what I'll do is I'll just keep saying all the Christian stuff and do the Christian dance until finally Pastor Dave believes in me enough that he puts me up on the stage. And I tell you what, I've been victim to that before because one area where I love to call the devil's bluff is when it comes to you guys. When it comes to you guys, when someone comes to me and they're like, I've got a dream and I've got something I've got to do. And then the devil whispers into my ears. Guess what? Guess what that person did last weekend? Guess what they did last month? Guess where they come out of? They're just going to wind up failing you. They're going to wind up not showing up. They're not going to be faithful. They're going to be a moral implosion. And I say, you're bluffing. I call your bluff. Not true. I believe more in them. I still get a little nervous. Why? Because I've done this before, and I've been out there, and I've made somebody a small group leader and a men's Bible study leader, and the next thing you know, he had a big moral sexual implosion, took a lot of Mezzanites with him, wound up just 6 months ago talking with one of the young ladies who was involved in the whole mess that was there, because if you don't know this, when you're a leader or an influence of stuff, if the devil can take you out, he takes out everybody underneath you as well. And this young lady said, I quit going to church, I quit going to Mezzanine, and I quit believing in God because I saw what men of God were like in him. And it cut to my core. And guess what? When I have to look at people and I have to process, the devil whispers into my head, remember him? Remember how that went down? Are you really going to promote that person? What if you have to face that again? And I'm saying, nope, you're bluffing. I believe in the gift of God. I believe in the Spirit of God. I believe that, you know what? They are redeemed, and that even if they fall, that they are a righteous man and woman, and they will stand up 7 times. And they will not stay there. They will not stay in that brokenness. He wants to have us believe that somehow we are spiritual roadblocks, our authorities, our caps, our filters to people. That's a danger when it comes to being a group like the Mezzanine, is sometimes you might feel too like you are the a person that a new believer or an outsider or someone who's looking at the faith has to get filtered through, and you get scared when you start losing that control of the person, when they start talking to other people about God, and you feel like you're losing your influence or you're losing your your ground in their heart. Devil's standing there saying, oh, well, what happens if that guy or that girl that maybe you have, you know, feelings for starts turning to other people, all of a sudden you don't have that God niche or God corner in their life. Or girls, for this too, you know, what if she starts making other friends and you're not her best friend anymore because she's now going to some other girl's Bible study, and you start feeling that pressure on your head, and you start feeling it, and you start saying stuff. You got to be careful about what authority and power and what influence does to us. It's one of the highest temptations that the devil tried to use to Jesus. We have to guard our hearts from it. Isn't it funny to think the strongest temptation, the sexual one, was the lowest, but the highest was the power one. The power one. We have to keep our hearts guarded. We have to keep our hearts guarded from it. We have to understand that God is the one who promotes us, and that we have to, man, let me tell you something super scary. I had a situation years ago where a student was involved, was being sexually abused. And she was young, and she was in junior high, and she had just gotten saved, and it was a situation where, like, the family was very new to the faith, and the mom was just, like, there, and I'm sure she was, like, I don't know how to say this without, I'm not trying to offend anybody, but didn't really know fully what was going on, and this young lady is getting abused, and she finally comes to the church and starts to talk and says, look, this man's abusing me, and he's related to me, and he's doing this stuff, and, you know, we, Pastor Brian and I and Allison, sat down, and we talked about it, and we prayed about it, and, you know, in me was like, let's call the mom. Let's call the mom and let's do this and let's do that and let's just give them, you know, a good scare or do something on that level. And Pastor Brian was like, nope, call the cops. And right then I was like, okay, mom's not coming back to church. This little girl's not going to come back to church. This whole thing is going to end in a horrible mess. Sure enough, we called the cops. Cops came in, banged on the door. They took some action. They did what cops and the police do, and child services went out, and they did what they did. And we're sitting here the whole time thinking, I'm thinking every Wednesday night, it's like, I'm watching that door. I mean, like, I know it's crazy to say and crazy to think, but I'm watching that door because we just wrecked that little girl's family. And that mom, we just wrecked her marriage. And I'm thinking, she's not going to come back. This family isn't coming back to the church. The devil was sitting there whispering in my ear the whole time, just lies. That girl comes walking back through this church. She's been at this church. She's still at this church. That mom is still at this church. That husband is off where he should be, all right, and away from that family and not abusing anybody anymore. But can you imagine what happens if every time the devil spoke, we just bowed down and said, okay, you're right. But now imagine your life where you say, no, I'm calling your bluff. I'm calling your bluff. Because that little girl is worth more to me than being afraid. I need to look at your life and the people in your life and say, seeing God's best for them means more to me than being afraid of you, devil. Than being afraid of what might happen to me. I'm not afraid of what's going to happen to me, but I'm going to see that my Father's will is done on earth and in heaven. And that's what we're called to do. And that's what we're called to do. I wrote something that I really wanted to say down, and I cannot find it. Here we go. Amanda, if you can come up now, we'll close out here with this thought. All right. Here we go. You know, King David, right? I'm going to be done in less than 5 minutes. So if you only got 5 minutes left in the tank, stay with me. Stay with me. Everybody say target. All right. They describe David. God describes David as a man after my own heart. King David, right? But why? What did he do that was so much better than all the rest of them? I mean, Moses parted a sea, right? Abraham, like, oh my gosh, he walked into a desert and prospered. I mean, John the Baptist dressed like a hippie and ate bugs. But, like, it says that David was a man after God's own heart. But why? Why was he a man after God's own heart? And we see that David, just like any one of us, he could fall to temptation. He struggled with power. He struggled with women. So it's like, you know what? People say, well, brother, it's because David knew how to repent. David knew to see the wrong in his life and knew to repent. And I'm here to tell you that that isn't the reason that God was like, that's my boy. That guy right there is after my heart. That's my squad. That's my tribe. That's my boy David right there. It isn't because he knew how to turn around when he made a mistake. Because if that was it, all of us would just get comfortable in our sin because of the grace given to us by our Father. And he's like, no, we weren't given the grace for that. David wasn't like that. And in the psalm, the 132nd psalm in the book, as he writes, as he's on the run from Saul, he's an outlaw. So guess what? He's got issues. David's got issues in his life. He has no home. He has no food. He doesn't know where he's going to stay the next night. Not to mention, he is wanted. He is FBI's most wanted. His life's on the line. Everything's on the line. I couldn't imagine the temptations he was going through then. This is what he says. He says, Lord, remember David in all his self-denial. He swore an oath to the Lord. He made a vow to the mighty one of Jacob. I will not enter my house or go into my bed. I will not allow sleep to my eyes or slumber to my eyelids till I find a place for the Lord, a dwelling place for the mighty one of Jacob. He says, God, you know what? I'm going to call that bluff. That God, you know what? I'm going to lower myself down to every temptation that's out there for me to turn myself in or give myself up or not passionately pursue you, throw myself at the feet of the king and just give in to him and say, whatever you do is right, which would have been horrible because Jesus was called to come from the line of David. Great people are called to come from the works that God has called you to. He's not calling you to compromise. He's not calling you to give in. He's saying, still faithful. Stay faithful, even though today is hard. Even though you can't see your future, because temptation is rendered powerless when you have self-denial and you are selfless. I'll say that a little clearer. When you deny yourself, temptation is disarmed. When you say, I'm not here to take from me. I'm not in this place to build my kingdom and take for me, but to give him glory. And that doesn't give him glory. I have no need of that. But he doesn't end there. This is why God loved David so much. I will not enter my house, nor go to bed, or allow no sleep to my eyes or slumber to my eyelids until I find a place for the Lord. He's saying, I won't rest. That, you know what, my job's not important, sleep's not important, eating's not important, that I'm going to have God, I'm going to have you in the center of my life, in the right place in my life, that you are the one that my life is centered around. At this very moment, he's talking about the Ark of the Covenant, the seat of God. He's saying that that seat isn't where it should be, and I am not going to rest until God's seat is in the right place in my generation and in my heart, because that seat says that the grace of God and the presence of God is reigning in your life. And we cannot live here and now looking at our lives with our bills and our finances and our class schedules dictating how we live. We put God in the center of our life and he organizes all the rest of that for us. So important that we don't go to rest. We don't rest until we've done that. Do we say, you know what, God? I'm going to make you the priority. And what's your priority will now become mine. And let me tell you, when you do that, you become a doctor that this world has never seen, a nurse that this world has never seen, an auto mechanic, a hair designer. All these things that you're called and you feel passionate about doing goes to a wholly another level because you are not standing on your ability, but you're standing on his righteousness and his grace and his anointing and his ability and the blessing flow in on his timing. You don't have to struggle so hard. We got to get him in the right place. It's more important than anything we do. That's why we have small groups on Monday night. Tuesday night and Wednesday night and Thursday night. Why? Because if you got questions about what it looks like to have God in the right place, you're not the only one. So does this guy. And if you have, you want to be around people that are also passionately doing that, guess what? You can do it. And say, man, this is what I'm dreaming. This is what I'm believing on doing. This is the direction I want to go. You can do it. People can say, man, and they can encourage you and they can support you. Or they can say, wait, I want to pray about that. Pray about that a little more. That's not what you want to be doing. But it all starts when you get God right back into that center place of your life. That Sunday isn't the day you go. Sunday isn't something you do. Church isn't something you do to get you out of all the stuff you did on Friday and Saturday night. But Sunday is there to catalyst you into just an amazing Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. And then go get filled up again. God, it's all about having him in the right place. And you'll wind up seeing that he's going to lead you to the right place where you're going to be. If I get the prayer counselors, come down, please. I'm going to close this in a prayer. If you need prayer for anything, come down and get prayer from these people. I just want to say that they're chasing God like you, and they're passionate for God like you. And, none of us are perfect, so if you're new, please don't think this microphone, the stage, or the fact that now all of them are also facing the wrong way is a statement that we feel that we're holier than anybody. We're just committed to believing with you and walking through life with you. So let us pray. Father, I just thank you for tonight. And I thank you that you have given us everything, and that with your presence in our life, the temptation can just fall off. We can say, no, I don't need that. Father, thank you for the strength. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Father, thank you for everything that you are doing here in these moments, God. I just speak to the hearts of everyone in the room that they will feel safe and secure to come and pray and speak what's on their heart and what you've been saying to them, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, guys. Let's do this. Let's do some life together for a little bit about 9:15, 9:20-ish. Let's shut the doors and let's go bowling. Nice. Lowest score has to pay.